Today I'm joined with John Gooden. How are you?
Doing all right, my friend. How are you?
I'm good, thank you. Obviously, being a UFC commentator, presenter, desk host, backstage reporter, how do you get into all of this?
Well, it goes back, I guess, goes back to when I was seven when I first started doing judo, I think. And then from there, it's been a journey through martial arts and sports. I guess ambitions to be a presenter when I was a little bit younger, but then things didn't kind of shake out the way that I wanted them to, so I'd given up on all of that. But then it was really MMA and my passion for the sport, seeing it done over here in the UK a certain way. I didn't quite agree with the way that it was being represented. I didn't like what the media was saying about our athletes. They, some of which were my friends, my teammates, coaches. So yeah, I kind of just started working within the UK MMA space, and it developed from there to a point where the UFC were looking to expand internationally. I was on the shortlist, and I'm very, very happy, proud of myself, and grateful that I managed to get the gig. And here we are today, nearly 10 years on.
You talk about the UFC fights in the UK back when they were presented as dogs and, cage fights, everything under the sun. How have you seen that evolve from then to tonight, today, where you see stars like Paddy the Baddy, Darren Till, Tom Aspinall?
Yeah, it's I don't know if I heard you correctly, but I don't know if they were described as dogs. Definitely the cutting aspect was something that I wasn't entirely comfortable with, and that was because none of the others really wanted to, none of the actual acting professionals wanted to be known as cage fighters. They wanted to be known as martial artists. It's a much nicer thing to be regarded as, and the connotations of cage fighting is, that they are negative. However, a lot of time has passed. I still think there's a great deal of work to be done over here in the UK. I still don't feel like people around the barbecue understand what mixed martial arts is. They don't know what MMA is. I say mixed martial arts, I feel like I get closer. If I mention the UFC, some people are like, oh yeah, the UFC. Some people not quite there. So then you have to go to Conor McGregor, and then we start to understand, or people start to understand what you're talking about. Paddy the Baddie is definitely someone who is resonating with a younger audience. I'm, funnily enough, I'm going to go and get this barnet cut a little bit later, and whenever I sit in the chair at the barber's, then they ask me about Paddy the Baddie. That's the guy that they seem to be connecting with, and that's a guy near London. Rather, and Paddy's obviously very, very much and very proudly Scouser. So it's great. We need all of these different personalities within the sport. And, we obviously haven't mentioned Leon, but you go to Birmingham and Leon's a superstar over there. He's so well respected. He's doing a lot of work in the community and through really through, well, he's got his community projects going on, but also just like a shining example of hard work from where these people have grown up in Birmingham, and look where he's managed to climb to and remains there. So we've got some really good examples of that. Michael Bisping, of course, for those that have followed the sport for such a long time, people have a great deal of respect for him, and Dan Hardy, of course. So yeah, it's nice now that we have a historical reference, but we also have these active professionals that are doing great things, leveraging the media really well.
How important do you think it is to have a UFC champion come from the UK? Obviously, we had, like you said, Bisping in the past, Leon now, kind of like with Russia, how they had Khabib, Petr Yan, Islam kind of stapled MMA in Russia. Important do you think that is to the UK?
Hugely important, because we've seen Leon Edwards on Soccer AM and going and doing the rounds on mainstream media. And that's how you cross over. That's how you get people that don't necessarily understand the sport. That's how you get them involved, because you get a good-looking fella, light-hearted guy like Leon turning up on Soccer AM, just having a bit of banter with the presenters, and people are like, oh, that guy's all right. So, oh, I didn't really think that they would look like that. Or it's just he represents the UK. He represents the West Indian community in the UK as well. He's a black athlete, so there's so many things. So many people can support him for so many different reasons. And when you're there on the BBC, like that's his opportunity to kind of tell his story and for people to get to see and hear him. And, you know, superhero status on the ground, if you like. So it's really important. And I know that Tom Aspinall has done some good stuff in the media, much like Molly and Paddy. And it's, you know, we got a real, there's a real cross section of guys and gals there, if you like, you know, in sizes and everything else. And it just shows how representative mixed martial arts can be. And it's so welcoming and celebrates people from all across the globe. And yeah, and I think it's beautiful that we get to show that. But of course, the higher you climb, you know, the greater your platform. So being a champion gives you all of those opportunities.
If you talk about Leon Edwards, how it's easy to support him because he has all these different things behind him. Being a UFC fan from the UK, it was hard to see him in 2020 to 2022 when he wasn't getting the opportunities. Obviously, he had the Bilal Muhammad fight, which ended in the eye poke, and it was hard to see him not getting the opportunities that he deserved.
No, you're 100% right. And I was lucky enough to be visiting him quite regularly through that time period. And I felt bad. You know, it was just with a combination of COVID and, you know, Leon trying to stick to his kind of business strategy, if you like, with that incredible win streak that he continues to run and not, you know, not making risky moves and doing what's right for his career. And, you know, he stuck to his guns and you have to applaud him for that. But, you know, then there were fights which he was preparing for, which didn't come good. And then of course it finally happens when he gets a bout against Bilal Muhammad. And then you have that incident with the eye, you know, his fingers in the eyes. And it's like, oh my God, this guy can't catch a break. It's just so unfortunate. And yeah, you start thinking it's God, it's just not going to happen for him, is it? But then he's climbed the hardest ladder, you know, and then that makes it all the more sweet for him and his team when he gets there and then defends it, because that's the key one, I think. Of course, you'll never take anything away from anyone that becomes a champion, but you'll always have these corners of the community saying, but you haven't defended, but you haven't defended. And then you defend it. And then what's left for someone to say? At that point, you've solidified your status as the champion. And yeah, and then it's bring it on. Then it's on to the next. Let's see how you can extend this streak and become one of the greats.
You talk about people saying it was a fluke or anything with the head kick against Kamaru Usman in
Well,
the
I
second.
didn't say it was a fluke. I just
Yeah,
say
you
that
did say.
sometimes I think you people will always, and maybe quite rightly, they want to see their champions defend their status.
Yeah, but seeing him defend it in London in the impressive way he did, how did you score that fight and what did you think of that fight afterwards?
Leon is a genius, and people are now realizing that. When I go up to Birmingham, I don't just see a fighter who has a team around him, passing him a water bottle and, you know, making sure that he's all good and like massaging him around between rounds. I see a guy that's a leader. You know, I see a guy in a room that wants everyone else around him to rise up to his level and greater. He is an example. He wants to be the example that can be done. It can be done from Birmingham with his selected coaching staff. And it takes a very knowledgeable, confident, clever athlete to be able to do that. I can't pretend, and I'm not even going to put myself in the same breath as in my athletic abilities as any of these UFC fighters. But let me just tell you, when I've tried to do any kind of sporting pursuit, I've always looked to someone. Like it confuses me if I have to look in different directions. I was training mixed martial arts since like 2006, and we would have to go to, I'd do my Muay Thai at minor tours. I'd do my, first of all, I'd do my Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu at Fight Factory. I'd put it together at the hybrid fighters. I was going to all these different places, and it was just too much for me. But Leon has been able to take lots of different opinions, filter out what's necessary, and then deliver with what's best for him. And he does that brilliantly. So I give you a kind of a long answer there because I'm trying to give my own perspective and what I've seen, and that is just a guy who can put together a strategy very, very well. He knows what he's good at, and he has the teamwork for him brilliantly so that they can come together and do what's necessary to beat arguably one of the great, well, he is one of the greatest, Kamaru Usman is one of the greatest welterweights we've ever seen in this sport. So to strategically be able to do what he needs to do to win the fight, to win the rounds is so very difficult against another guy who's very good at that as well, obviously. So I was very happy for him to do it in that fashion, because you have to, he beat Kamaru Usman over the distance. And yes, I believe that he won the fight. I don't think there was any controversial decision there. These fights are close at the top. That's just what they are. You know, we had one on the weekend just gone as well. It's but Leon put in a great performance on the night, and you know, he gets a knockout win, and he does, he stretches it over the distance as well. So that's probably best case scenario, I think.
You think it's more impressive to get a knockout win like you did in where was it? Utah, or get a 5-round decision win over someone like
It's,
Kamaru Usman?
let's make no bones about it. It is it the knockout made Leon. The knockout gave us this story. The knockout sent Leon onto the small screen, and possibly the big screen down the line. And that's me speculating, by the way. But his story is a movie in the making. In actual fact, I should probably go and put a bid in to see if I can get the rights to it. Seriously, you know, he's to have that kind of finish, and now his story's not done. He might have another head kick dead down the line. But you know, let's go back to that Gunnar Nelson fight. He, for me, he out-grappled Gunnar Nelson. You know, he outpointed Kamaru Usman over five. He knocked out Kamaru Usman, like at the point where everyone was, where Kamaru Usman was coming off of knockout victories himself, looking like an even better striker than what he's ever appeared to be before. So he's beating guys at their own game, and I'm excited to see what comes next.
Talking about UFC in England, how was it UFC London? Obviously on TV the atmosphere was unreal. How was it like being in the arena that night?
That the Leon Kamaru card,
Yeah.
that one was a difficult one for me to say because I was backstage. So
All right.
being backstage, you don't get to feel the energy quite so much. But I can obviously tell you from going back to, I think, I guess it's this time last year, God, time flies, or well, March last year when we'd returned after a 3-year hiatus. I mean, it was chill. It was just chills. The energy, the enthusiasm to be back, the cheering. A lot of people will know this. When I mean, you can see it on the TV as well. But largely, a UFC event's a celebration of what we see. Unless you've got a polarizing character, you don't hear too many boos on a fight night in percentage terms. So all you've got is just, you know, to 20,000 people just cheering. You know, they're celebrating big moments, but the walkouts, they're singing along, particularly the UK fans, or those fans that descend upon London, that they are perhaps football fans that are used to singing songs. They make up songs for their favorite fighters. It's just wonderful. In France, we had the national anthem, like a cappella style, which was
That was
like
goosebumps.
a spot moment. So beautiful, right? Absolutely beautiful stuff. And that's what's so incredible about live sports, and the UFC have got it down, and the fans know what they expect of themselves now. We're going back to London in July, and those fans will be like, we want to go one better than what we saw earlier in the year. We want to recreate that atmosphere that we had back in 2022 in March, you know. So fingers crossed we have the fights to complement that kind of environment.
Who do you want to see on that July card? Obviously, it's been a fight night, so it's
All of
most
them,
like.
all of them. 20 fight card, you know, all the names from the region. Like, bring it on! Of course, I'd like to see the return of Tom Aspinall. It's not. I don't think Paddy's going to be ready, is he? I'm not sure. I
But
still
he's still
see.
recovering, isn't he?
Say again. Sorry.
He's still recovering from his injury, isn't he?
Yeah, I believe so. So we're not going to see him. But yeah, I think we're at a stage now where finally, the UFC, the people that come to watch the UFC fights in London, realize that this isn't like a an alternative sort of Cage Warriors card. Those fighters have served their time on the local circuit and have kicked on and have fought at, the very, very best, and they're coming home to London. And I now enjoy seeing people celebrate these athletes that are British, but we want to see them, not just a big American stars. Of course, we'll happily entertain blue chip names from all around the world, because this is one of the biggest fighting venues. And actually, I can let you in that when I see UFC fighters on the road who are perhaps from like Australia or North America, they want to come to London because they want to feel that energy from the fans. So of course we'd like to take them, but it's important now for the development of our sport to have our big names fighting out of London so that they can get to enjoy it. Because often they don't get to be out in front of these big crowds. A lot of the stars that we are seeing emerge now fought through the pandemic where there was no crowd. They really made their mark and had their important fights over that sort of 2022 period. So given that opportunity, and I think that the UFC do that, but it's what's nice now. I've seen the change from the appetite from the fans to really get behind those names as well. So I know I applaud them for that.
You talk about some of our big fighters making their names over the pandemic. Obviously, Tom Aspinall looks like a future world champion at heavyweight, made his name in Abu Dhabi and Las Vegas. How important do you think that homecoming was against Alexander Volkov, and then against
Yeah, no, I make that
Curtis
mistake
Blades?
as well. Yeah. Yeah, the Curtis Blaydes is obviously a forgettable moment for Tom. It was just the worst moment of his career, and there's nothing he could do about that. When these things happen, it was just awful. So he would have wanted that to have happened back on Fight Island, I'm sure. But yes, let's go back to that wonderful moment against Volkov, where it all came together for him. And he's so real that he was telling us all, I really don't know how I'm going to react when I first walk out to a live crowd in my nation's capital against a perennial contender who's got so much more experience, but yet he is so very confident. I still speak to Tom like fairly regularly, check in with him, and he's sounding like he's in really good spirit. He's saying he's better than ever right now. So he'll walk out there, whether he's main event, co-main event, wherever it might be on the card, with a level of comfort that he's been through it before, and perhaps he can enjoy it. But now he wants to obviously get back in the mix. Such a brilliant time for the heavyweight division. There's lots of moving pieces, and he'll want to show some form so that he can maybe get the opportunity to fight a guy like John Jones, who sounds like he's making noises that he's not going to be around for too much longer. So if Tom can put in a performance that whets the appetite of the goats, then that's a big payday for him. That's a big stage. It's a big challenge, and that's what these fighters are here to do.
Obviously, talking about UFC heavyweights, you were at Serhii Plavic versus Curtis Blaydes. How was that like at the Apex?
Yeah, that was intense, because heavyweight fights just have this kind of mystique about them, don't they? They are the biggest men on the planet, throwing some serious force around. So I if Pavlovich was going to win, that was the way that he was going to win. If Blades was going to win, then we were really going to see the mettle of Sergei Pavlovich, and see like his resistance to that. So yeah, that was predictable if you were in the camp of Pavlovich. But I don't really get the strategy from Curtis Blaydes. It seemed like he really wanted to prove himself in the striking department. I know that he has wonderful striking, but I just think a guy that's coming in with so much confidence so early on as well to engage with him, I just yeah I thought that we might have seen a different approach from Curtis, and And who knows now, but the result may have been different, might not have been. Maybe Sergei Pavlovich has answers in all ranges, but we're going to find out. I mean, he's young in his UFC career, but he's looking absolutely ridiculous at the moment. And that is kind of what's interesting about heavyweights is you can accelerate to the top very quickly, but it's like careful what you then like fast track yourself into, because a man match up with John Jones, who's just, youngest UFC champion, been around for so very long, done it across two weight classes. Like, you're not going to run over that guy. And he has a voodoo about him before you get in there. You're going to have a very strong mind to not let the demons come in, because the reality is you're facing one of the deadliest men to walk the planet.
It's kind of that aura that we saw, obviously, Conor McGregor have back in the day when he won fights before even stepping foot in the cage. How important do you think that is, the mind game to a fight?
Well, John doesn't even need to play a game. Like, and there is no one, there is no one that has a bigger aura than John Jones. It simply doesn't. And he can be playful with it if he wants. He can lean into it if he likes. He can do what the heck he wants, because John Jones has proved in every way that he can, that he can win a fight. So, very, very interesting, and that's why I'm interested for him to stick around as long as we can. Not so that we see him get beaten, by the way. That's not what was kind of aiming at. But just to see off the different challenges, just to see who can overcome the mental battle, and then give us a really good fight. Because I think some people are so affected. Over the years, I'm not just talking with a recency bias, but over the years, people are affected by it, and that really takes away from what they can bring to the octagon. So, I mean, Anthony Smith has spoken about this. This isn't like a secret. So, yeah, let's hope that we get to see him for a few more outings, but I don't know if that will be the case.
Well, like you said, you don't hope him to leave, but if he loses to Tom Aspinall, I don't think either of us would mind that.
If Tom can get in there, that would be wonderful. But he will face those challenges that everyone else does as well. I'm certainly not going to sit here and say that he won't. But he's up for it. And this is the balance. These fighters want the biggest challenges. They want to measure themselves against the best in the world. But at the same time, there comes a responsibility with that. There comes a weight, and you've got to try and get a good. To have a good balance with it, so that it's a healthy amount of energy and it doesn't overwhelm you.
Do you think, obviously talking about John Jones, who would be your Mount Rushmore UFC fighters of the greatest of all time?
God. Well, John's up there. GSP's up there for me. Anderson Silva's up there for me. I'm saying this quickly now. I haven't prepared for that one. I don't know how many are on Mount Rushmore. That's a terrible thing to
It's
say.
four, isn't it?
Is
Four or
it
five?
four? Oh, Jesus. It's really difficult. It's such a difficult you I think it's so difficult, because I've been watching this sport for so long, and there are fighters back in the day like Randy Couture, who I absolutely love. And I feel like they need to be respected as well. I can't ever walk. I can't. GSP for me has to be someone that's in that conversation. John Jones has to be in that conversation. You also look at Demetrius Johnson, but can I put him over? I've got to put Conor McGregor in there, just because of what he's done for the sports. And then I'm really looking at the likes of Israel Adesanya. How many did I give you there? Did I give you three?
Yeah,
Well,
three,
let me. I'm going to put Randy Couture. So Randy Couture, John Jones, GSP, and Conor McGregor. Probably get some people coming back at me for that, but I haven't sat down with my thoughts for very long. Yeah, that's probably one that I should sit with for a while. But it is changing. When you see people extend their when you see extend their resume. Like Israel Adesanya does. I'm a huge Adesanya fan, and what he was able to do recently as well, just like another guy with an incredible story, such an impressive body of work. And yeah, I'm not even, I haven't even mentioned Jose Aldo and like Volkanovski, but
Or even
yeah, I
Anderson
do like
Silva.
to, I do like to tip my cap to the guys from the forefathers as well, because I do feel like things were even harder in some respects because of the resources that were available. Perhaps the competition level maybe wasn't quite what it is today, but even so, without what they've done, we wouldn't be where we are today.
How important do you think it is the fights like you've previously mentioned, Randy Couture, and the people that laid the groundwork for the Conor McGregors, the Michael Bispins, all the fights we see today? How important were they to lay the groundwork for the fights we see
They're
today?
essential. Everyone, it's building a wall brick by brick, and we wouldn't have the solid wall that we have now if we didn't have the foundational elements. And Chuck Liddell, Chael Sonnen, trash talk and results, by the way, I don't want to diminish what he achieved in the octagon. Michael Bisping, going back, I was on the stage with Ian Freeman at the last UFC events, and without his efforts, that performance against Frank Mir, like where would that leave the UFC's ambitions to develop the UK market even more? So we have people in different regions that have done so much. You'll go over to Australia and they'll have their own catalogue of fighters that, even guys like George Sotiropoulos, I've probably got his name wrong, but that on the Ultimate Fighter against Ross Pearson. And these people have all served in a way, and they were a little before their time, maybe. They wouldn't have had the big bucks that we're getting into now, but all the same, people were in the gym getting inspired by them. And what's nice for me actually is I'm seeing some of the fighters that I used to commentate on earlier in my days now turn to coaching and be giving us wonderful students that are coming to the highest level as well. Like my coach David Lee was on the UFC back in the day. He fought for the UFC a couple of times, and he's now turned out Sam Patterson, who's with the UFC now, Charlie Leary's who's with Bellator. So yeah, it's wonderful now that we're stretching across a few generations, and we can see that trajectory of the sport, but we shouldn't forget those greats. So I do try my best to shine a light when appropriate, and yeah, thank you for their continued service to this sport, because it's been a labor of love.
You talk about all the fighters that have the experience going into coaching. How important do you think it is for them to teach their students, especially their experience? We see Brad Pickett do it with Nathan Wood.
Yeah, it's so important, because the times have changed, but a fight's a fight, and these guys have been around across different generations. They've also guys like Brad have trained internationally. They've picked up different systems. They get it. They've trodden the boards, and that's what it's all about, right? For all of us in the work that we do, we should all be like essentially laying it all out so that someone can look at it, learn from it, develop it, do better than what we did, and then grow whatever it might be. We're talking about mixed martial arts, grow the sport beyond where we could have an influence. So it's almost, I feel, we almost have a duty, in whichever facet we approach the sport, to do that, to help the next generation. Because we obviously have managed to assemble some kind of wisdom.
I thought you just cut out then, just lagged a little bit.
All right, did you catch what I was, did you catch the last bit of what I said?
Yeah.
Okay.
But going on, you went to Australia for UFC 284, Volkanovski versus Makhachev. How did you find that experience going to the other side of the world?
Yeah, I love Australia. I've been there a few times with the UFC now. That was a special trip. The crowd there was as good as any crowd ever that I've ever been around. Really, really was. And I've gotten to know some of the guys on the Aussie circuit as well, and it was good to see good to see them have such a good night, and really put in some fantastic performances, have a great event in their country as well to try and keep that momentum going. They had it really hard with the pandemic. Their government locked their island down. And I don't think people understand how difficult it is for the Aussie fighters and the guys from New Zealand as well. They are so far away from everywhere. The efforts that they have to take and make to just to get competition is ridiculous. Like being locked away for 2 weeks after coming back from a fight in a small hotel room with your team, not seeing your family on top of everything else is just so painful, but they did it. A number of guys like Dan Hooker did it multiple times, I think. So real credit to them, and it was lovely for them to then have that experience of a live UFC event. Perth, a new area for I don't think it was that. No, I think actually it was a different state in I think it was Melbourne that they had banned or had certainly hadn't sanctioned mixed martial arts. But I know that they've had their troubles with local authorities. But yeah, Western Australia finally got the UFC back over there. It was special for me as well because a friend of mine, Ben Vickers, who runs Eternal MMA, the local promotion, the top Aussie promotion that is based out of Western Australia. I got to see him. I got to see his student, Jack Della, post another great performance. I went down to their gym. I was training there. I had a good conversation with Ben, which is on UFC Fight Pass. So if you guys want to know about how they do in Perth and a little bit more about Jack Della Maddalena and Ben's journey, please check that out. So yeah, it was a lovely experience for me.
How important do you think it is for Australian MMA? Obviously, we were talking about English MMA before. How important do you think it is for them to have that crowning event and then have stars like Volkanovski, Israel Adesanya, Dan Hooker?
It's what you need. It's all the ingredients to make the recipe. You need the UFC to turn up so that the mainstream fans don't think that it's just something that's happening on the other side of the planet, so that they can get behind it as well. Because if you're going to invest in something, you kind of want a return on your investment, right? And that is to go to these shows, to be able to see these athletes that you're stalking on social media. And the UFC events give you that opportunity, as well as fan engagement stuff and other things that go on throughout the year. But if you get behind the MMA community, then it will reward you with these things. And but I think the Aussie and Australasian athletes are very easy to support and get behind. I think they're very personable. Guys like Volkanovski is an absolute legend. I think people finally get him. I think they're finally really, like, the world over getting behind him. And especially after that Makachev performance as well. He's trying to do things that aren't previously done. He's such a gentleman. I honestly can't speak highly enough of Volk. I think I was on his debut. I got to commentate his debut, and ever since that moment, he's always stayed the same guy. He's always had time for little old me, and his team. Really, really get on well with those guys, and you can't help but celebrate their success, with everyone else. So, I think that answers your question.
How important do you think it was for Volk to close that chapter with Max Holloway beating him 3 times over about 3 years?
Well, I don't, how important will it be? I think he's done it, really. I mean, not that I'm saying I don't want to see it again, because Holloway has just proved to be the immovable object outside of Volkanovski, so he's earned his shot at the top, regardless of what's gone before. But I don't think that there's anything really that I need that I. Any outstanding questions that needed answering immediately. I think the thing here, the storyline here, is that Max is so damn good that he did, and he has fought his way back to then get another crack at Volkanovski. But the thing is, you always get to a point where, you give a top athlete 10 cracks at something, they're gonna win one of them, because they're that good and the margins are so very small. So many things need to come together on fight night for these athletes to have a great performance. that there's going to be a day when, if you put them in there enough, there's going to be a day when Holloway will beat Volkanovski. It's just the probabilities. So there is that to consider. But yeah, but Holloway again, another. I mean, he's going to go down as a great in the sports, regardless of whether he picks up another golden belt. Like, for me, he's an absolute legend. Like, I feel like we've seen him grow up, and he seems to be getting better. Yeah, he really does. He's like a fine wine, that boy.
Do you think it's important the journey we see these fighters go on? Obviously, talking about Max Holloway, made his UFC debut at 21, I think. Then seeing him now at nearly 30, being pretty much a champion. Granted, he hasn't got the belt now, but do you think that's important, seeing that journey as a fan and as a commentator?
Yeah, it gives you things to talk about, and that allows the relationship between the athletes and the fans to develop. They've gone on this journey, this roller coaster with them. The fighter has provided them all of these moments to celebrate, which gives you an emotional attachment. And in return, the fans send the notes, have the meets and greets, and they give them all the words of encouragement, or perhaps the other way. Some fighters wouldn't say they enjoy it, but they kind of they react in a positive way often to the criticism that is levied at them, and then that gives them an opportunity to say, okay, doubt me now, here we go, what do you say now? And then often you see that corner of the world go, oh yeah, all right, I've got it wrong, sorry, you've won me over as a fan.
Obviously, as well as being an MMA fan, you're an Arsenal fan. How do you see the running going for you lot?
Oh God, yeah. Well, the run-in last season didn't go too well, so the form guide on that doesn't look very positive. But we had a good result against Newcastle, which was the game that I was most nervous about in, obviously, a like post Man City. I didn't expect to be getting any great result there. The games that went before that, I think it was West Ham, Southampton. I think not getting the results there is just like, are you kidding me? Here we go again. And if we could have gotten results there, then I think it makes for an even more exciting run-in for the neutral to the end of the season. But I look at City's strength of schedule, and I'm hopeful here, but with those Real Madrid games and what they've got left in the Premier League, like if they come out of that unscathed and they don't drop points, then good luck to them, because I mean, they're an incredible side, they really are. I think Arsenal can do it though. I think we can keep up the pressure. It's all down to the results of Man City now, I'm afraid.
With the Everton game on Sunday, it's such a huge game, like you said, sandwiched between those two huge Real Madrid games if they want to go on and win the Champions League.
Yeah, I mean, what do you yeah, it's so difficult, right? It's so difficult for them, but they are one of those sides with a huge depth of squad, and that's where it comes into play at this part of the season. So, they've certainly got the personnel for it, but let's see what they do. I mean, hopefully, sorry, of course, I want them to drop. They need to drop big points as well for us. It can't just be drawing games. They need to lose, unless they, because I can't see them drawing multiple games coming in. So yeah, and Arsenal needs to, because we're not going to catch them on goal difference, not without that absolute monster, the Haaland they've got up top all season. God, he's a frightening prospect, isn't he? Yeah, fingers crossed we get it done.
Well, thank you so much for your time, John. Thank you for coming on. It's been a pleasure.
No worries. All right, take care. So good to chat.
You too. Thank you.